thankful to God for being here this morning. I am in awe of Pastor Hudson for even allowing me to be here today to celebrate and to bring a word for your 133rd church anniversary. I'm in awe of how much that means to me, and I'm very thankful. I was talking to my brother over here who's at STVU at Virginia Union now. He's going to come out this year, and I just graduated in May. And I'm thankful to God that Reverend Hudson, I'm thankful. I know that people, they get in their minds that they're going to do things, and you know, committees are formed, and people say we're going to do this, that, and the other, but unless it comes from the head, you know, when I saw your signature, and I actually felt the letter to see your signature. But I'm very thankful to God for being here this morning and for all of you, the dear sweetheart that met me, and all of you that I know so well. It is a blessing to be here to celebrate your 133rd church anniversary. It's been a weird spirit in here this morning, I have to admit. And some of it has been kind of, Lord, help us please. Because we're supposed to be celebrating and thankful for so much that God has done.
Yeah.
But it's kind of been something sitting on us or something this morning. I don't know what that was. And the music is not, you know, that doesn't make a difference. The drums don't make no difference. That ain't what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Spirit of God to come in and actually move and do what He is going to do. So I'm just prayerful that God is allowing us to be kind of somber and maybe laid back because He's preparing our hearts for what it is that He wants you all to receive today.
Amen.
And I pray that you will receive what He has for you today. Lord God, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for safe travel. Lord God, you saw all those cars and trucks whizzing by me this morning, and you just kept me in the cleft of the rock. And you got me down here safely without harm, hurt, danger. God, thank you so much for St. John, how you have blessed them all these years. Lord, you have used this church to even start from a little place where people had to move and lose their homes and their property because the government said, we coming and taking it over.
Yeah.
But God, you knew from the very beginning. You knew the end of the thing. From the beginning of the thing. And we thank you, God, that you have brought us thus far along the way.
Yes.
Now, Lord, please don't allow us to get to this place and then stop and get stagnant. But help us, Lord, to hear what you say and move according to your will and to your word. We thank you, God, for what you're about to do. And I pray, God, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, my dear Savior and my Redeemer. And I pray, God, that you would open the hearts and the ears of these people, that they will not pay too much attention to me, but hear what it is that you have sent for them to know. God, it ain't by accident that I'm here. I know that. And I'm thankful to you for the assignment. And I claim it done in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I know that all of your ushers back there are not looking down in their laps because they all count their fingers. So if you got your phone back there, take your phone and go to your Bible app and look at Psalm number 133. That's right. You incorporate technology in the church service. People got Facebook and Twitter and all that stuff. Y'all Twitter and Facebook your friends and tell them what the scripture is for today. And let them know that you are in church, and they ought to be here too. Well, you can put that down. Don't put that down right now. All right, I love you, but I don't want that right now. I'm Cora, y'all. I can't be nobody else but. Ain't gonna try to be nobody else but. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version, which is what we were taught in seminary. Is the only version that we ought to be looking at. And you don't have to stand. Please sit down. Yeah, we honor tradition today. We just want to thank and let the Lord speak to us and use us in a way where He gets the glory and we get the blessing. Now look at the word then. It says, behold. That's what the cross is. The cross is, we're in communication and unity with God first, and then with each other. And the point going down, Dr. Faith Harris taught me, is how we live and love our world that we live in, the ground that we walk on. We need to respect it, live in unity with it. God, each other, and our world, to live in unity. How pleasant it is when we can do that, when there's no big eye. When there's no shot callers who say you're going to do it my way or the highway. But we live in unity. I said a little while ago, we're not going to always agree. I used to belong to a church family. I don't want to belong to a church family right now. God has not given me a church family nor a pastor yet. And I've been praying and asking him for one. But as I visit churches, I'm thankful that he has not given me one. Because the devil is raging everywhere.
Yes.
In the pulpits. In the pews. God knows he's raging in the choir stand. That's why where most of the big fights are. In the music ministry of God's house. Do you know why? Because the enemy, the devil, used to be one of the most musical and beautiful angels that God had. And he got so big for his riches, he decided, oh yeah, I'm the best.
Yes.
And he and his little imps and angels were all kicked out. And he's got a thing for stirring up trouble in music ministry ever since. And we fall to that stupid stuff. Because we want to be big. We want to be the head. We want to get the bigger check. Well, how beautiful it would be if we lived in unity. In unity with God and with each other. I watched some of those young ushers when they were on the doors around the mall. And I don't know what they were doing, but it just looked nice that they kind of like had contact with each other. Working together, working well together. It was so funny to me because when I first got here, it was a situation outside. And it was just funny to me that, you know, adults don't always work that well together. And sometimes we just gotta check ourselves. Just wait a minute, Lord, am I really looking like I'm in unity with you and my sisters and brothers and I act like that? Yeah, you've come 133 years. You cannot assume that you're going 133 more. You cannot. We will probably won't be here for another 133 years. But who says that St. John can't be? These young people are growing and growing and growing and growing.
I'm
in there with a good attitude. Please! I've been in enough church meetings to know that's a lie from the pit to hell. Because there are those of us who get very offended when it's not our way. And when we leave the place where we're supposed to be in unity and unified, we have another meeting outside. No, don't get me wrong. I'm not your typical Baptist preacher. Let me help y'all with it, because some of y'all, they have not heard me before. Let me help you. The Lord sends me on assignments, and I am not a pastor. And so what he puts in my mouth to give to whoever he sends me to is not going to make everybody happy. But it ought to make you think. The Word of God helps us to look not at other people and point the finger. Now, you see, you clap. What you clapping for? What it's supposed to help you do is take the mirror and look at yourself. So then, we're living in time that we need to be in unity with God, with each other. Because God has kept us thus far along the way. When other people look at St. John, I wonder what do they see? That's a good question. I remember when Reverend Weston was here. This is another one of those things that I'm like, what in the world is this about? You're blocking people off.
Because I couldn't understand. Well, God, how can you bless them? And then
are so busy judging other people. But it's not unity. It's not unity. God is the judge. And I come to find out that God sent Jesus to all the places that the church people thought Jesus ought not to be. So St. John, yes, you've done well 133 years and God has blessed you financially. He's given you land, given you a building, helped you renovate it. Don't know why you chose these color windows. I digress, that's my personal opinion.
You know how come I know?
Because you have a strong will that you want to do what you want to do.
Yeah.
So when you walk out of the church, you're right. When you got to the church, you're going to be a force to be reckoned with for the kingdom of God.
Yes.
I know it's a lie. So that means that, John, you have to get off of your seat of tradition and doing nothing because you think somebody else is going to do it. And do something to engage these young people in a way that these young people need to be engaged. I laughed at you when they were up there, they were trying to pray. And you were trying to hold both of these babies at one time. Is for us to get a new wind, to go to God.